All right, I see a whole bunch of people joining. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. We're really excited to be hosting this webinar for you on the Arribada. I'm going to give folks a minute to jump in. That number is rising very quickly. We were honestly stunned at how popular and interested people were on this. For this webinar, we had about 500 people register. So we'll see how many people are actually able to make it live. We are recording this, so just so everybody knows. And we will send out a recording of it to everybody who registers, who has registered, so that you will get the recording if you have to leave early or anything. We're probably going to go a little bit over an hour with all the different presenters that we have. Yeah, we're going to have several presentations and then some time for question and answers at the end. So to try to keep us on time, I'm going to start us off. I'm Brad Nahill with Sea Turtles. I'm the president and founder of Sea Turtles. I'm going to give you just a very quick introduction to our organization before we kick everything off. So I need to share my screen. It's been a while since we've done a webinar, and we're having some weather issues both in Costa Rica and in Mexico. So we're going to cross our fingers, hope everything goes smoothly here. We'll see. We'll cross our fingers. Let me go ahead and let's see, share my screen. There we go. All right. Can you see that okay, Adriana? Yeah. Okay. Great. Yes, this webinar, we're calling it The Mystery of the Arribada. The Arribada is a unique thing in the sea turtle world. There's a lot that we've learned about it and why it happens and things like that, but there's still a ton of mystery and things that we're trying to solve about this phenomenon. And so we're going to explore what it is and how it works. We're going to see some tremendous video footage today, and we're going to talk to a bunch of experts. So Sea Turtles, we're a nonprofit sea turtle conservation organization. We have several different programs that we run. Billion Baby Turtles supports more than 60 turtle nesting beaches around the world. We've helped save almost 10 million baby turtles at these projects that we support, these locally based projects. Too Rare to Wear is a campaign that works to end the trade in hawksbill tortoiseshell products. Sea Turtles in Plastic works to get plastic out of sea turtle habitats and in some places recycle that plastic into useful things that can support local communities and conservation efforts. And we're going to hear about one of those projects today. We also offer trips to go and work hands-on with sea turtles, including to one of these Arribada sites, Escobilla in Oaxaca. We run Sea Turtle Week every year, where we have lots of partners around the world who work with us every June to raise awareness about sea turtles and the threats that they face and things that people can do to help them. And finally, we have our Sea Turtle Inclusivity Fund, which works to support members of the local communities where sea turtles live to help them advance in their careers. So our presenters tonight, we have our program director, Dr. Adriana Cortez, who lives in Mazunte, very close to Escobilla, one of the top Arribada beaches in the world. She will include a short interview with Rafa Villanueva, who works in Escobilla, and she had a chance to visit. An Arribada just ended a couple of days ago and had a chance to visit and do a short interview with him. Live from the beach with the turtles all around. We're also going to share a pre-recorded interview with Jamie Curtis Hayward, who's with Silverback Films. if you've seen the Our Planet show on Netflix, Our Planet 2 recently came out, Adriana was the scientific advisor for that program, helping them to film some incredible footage from the Arribada in multiple places. And so we have an interview with some of the footage from that. After that will be a pre-recorded presentation by Dr. Luis Fonseca with Costa Rica Por Siempre, who works on a couple of Arribada beaches in Costa Rica. That one will be in Spanish, but we have it subtitled. And then Luis will join us for the Q&A if there are any questions about his work. And then we will finish with a live presentation from Dr. Vanessa Beese with the Wildlife Conservation Association, who also lives right alongside Ocional, which is one of the major Arribada beaches in Costa Rica. And she will talk about her research, Ocional, and then some of the plastic work that we've supported. And also, just to quickly note, we've also supported Luis's work through our Billion Baby Turtles program in Costa Rica as well. So everyone's here is friends and partners. And so, so Sea Turtles, we're going to send out an email to everybody who registered with all of our socials and links to our website, our trips, and how you can help support sea turtle conservation efforts. We'll also send out links to Luis's work, Vanessa's work, things like that afterwards. So that will probably come out tomorrow with the recorded version of the presentation. So with that, I am going to, I'm going to stop sharing. And now I'm going to pass it over to Adriana, who is going to start off with an introduction about the Arribada itself. So let's see, there you go. You are now the host.
Okay. Well, thank you, Brad. Thank you, everyone, for being here. We were very happy about sharing all this experience with you. And yes, I am the program of directors in Sea Turtles, and also I'm lucky to live just 30 minutes away from Escobilla, where I also did all my master's, PhD, and postdoc research for many years. So I want to share with you a little introduction about the Arribadas. Maybe many of you are familiar with, but it's always good to go to the basics. And if you can see, well, Brad, I cannot see you, but well, if you say nothing, it's that you are watching this fine. So, yeah, thank you. Well, I just want to talk first about what is an Arribada. Brad already said, most of you should know, but well, just to say, the term Arribada has been used to refer both to a physical place, a nesting beach and nurture waters, and to the synchronous nesting behavior of a large number of redlies over just a few days. Usually it's more than 1,000 turtles, what makes a place, a beach, an Arribada beach. The species, the only two species from the seven species of marine turtles are redlies. To show this behavior, Kim's Ridley in the Gulf of Mexico and Olive Ridley, the one that is all around the world. So this is only two species presenting these Arribadas. Kim's Ridley, on one hand, is endemic of the Gulf of Mexico. It has three important Arribada beaches in Mexico, two in Veracruz, Playa Chaparrales and Chachalacas, and one in Tamaulipas, Rancho Nuevo, which is the most important one for this species. It is categorized as critical endangered by the IUCN. And usually this population was decreasing for many years. The last 4 years, it's been a little bit more stable. In 2022, they have a little bit more than 22,000 nests from this species, which is good news, but still a lot of work to do with them. And the other one is Olive Ridley, which is the one where we are going to talk more today. Olive Ridley are found through the world. The Arribadas are happened in Mexico, Costa Rica, and India. I will show you a little bit more with detail in the next slide about the specific places. It is categorized as vulnerable by the IUCN. And today there are 5 major sites, greater than 100,000 nests per year, and 8 to 10 minor sites, varying between 10,000 and 100,000 nests per year in the world. So in this map, you can see a little bit more about the Arribada places. As I say, it's mostly Mexico, Costa Rica, and India, which have the greatest population. But here, I will show you. This is for Mexico. We have the two largest beaches with more nests in Playa La Escobilla and Morrayuta. We also have Estapilla and 3 other beaches that has been historically show some arribada behavior. And the last years, for example, Piedra de Tlacoyuque has been having more and more nests, more than 1,000. So it is considered that a new, like arribada behavior beach. And in Costa Rica, they have Nancite, Ocional, and when increasing, like a new beach as well, when increasing population, Corozalito. In Nicaragua, they also have La Flor, Echacocente. We don't have a lot of information about these two, but they are also an important population. In Panama also, they have, let's say, a small Arribada beach, like an increasing population and smaller, but they have Isla Cañas and Playa La Marinera. And in India, they have Gajimarta, que is usually the most important one, Devi, and Rushikulia. And then I will focus more in Mexico, whereas where I live, where I have more experience about. And as I said, I am very lucky to be working for many years in Escobilla. And as researcher, doing all my research work there. So I've been there for many, many arribadas. And actually, it was my first beach where I saw my first turtle many, many years ago, and where I decided that I wanted to protect sea turtles. Some facts that the largest arribada sites in Earth have been historically in Mexico, with the largest occurring on Playa Escobilla. Beginning on the 60s and continuing for 3 decades, tens of thousands of turtles were killed annually in Mexico to provide olive-friendly hides to a growing international trade, which used the hides as a substitute for scarce crocodile leather. There was a slaughterhouse at San Agustinillo, which is just the town before beside me. I live in Mazunte, was shut down in the 90s. And then it was created the Centro Mexicano de la Tortuga, the Mexican Turtle Center, here in the town of Mazunte, like to change this when Mexico stopped the permanent exploitation in the 90s, to do this shift, they created the Mexican Turtle Center. And nesting at Playa La Escobilla subsequently increased fivefold, from approximately 200,000 nests per year in the 90s to a more than 1 million by the year of 2000. And then this number is currently stable and increasing actually in some years, with about 9 arribada events per year. The nearby beach at Morrayuta also hosts more than 1 million nests each year. And it's also a slightly increasing population. But I wanted to talk with the experts of this. So I went to Escobilla last week. There was an arribada, and I was thinking where the place to make an interview than during the arribada. So I'm sorry for the audio, but I hope you can enjoy this visit with the manager of the field station, Rafa.
Hola, muy buenas tardes. Soy Rafael Villanueva Alcázar, encargado del santuario Playa de Escobilla.
Gracias, Rafa, por aceptar esta invitación y esta entrevista. Como pueden ver, estamos en el santuario de la Escobilla en medio de una de las arribadas más grandes, y no es que la más grande de este año, ¿verdad, Rafa?
Sí, así es. Ahorita parece que las tortugas empezaron a salir desde hace 4 días y ya llevamos un número considerable.
¿Y qué nos puedes contar de la Escobilla, Rafa? Cuéntanos un poco más de las arribadas.
Escobilla es un área natural protegida con categoría de santuario. que principalmente la actividad es conservar a la tortuga. Aquí en esta playa más o menos tiene un promedio de 6 a 10 arribadas por temporada y va desde 20.000 a unos 500.000 tortugas por cada arribada. Las primeras arribadas son muy cortas, van de 3 a 4 días y las más largas tardan entre unos 10 a 15 días.
¿Y qué nos puedes contar acerca del trabajo que llevan ustedes a cabo en esta playa?
Sí, claro, como pueden ver, la playa está posteada cada 50 metros. Tenemos postes a lo largo de toda la playa. En esta playa también se llega tortuga fina, prieta y la última. La playa tiene una extensión de 18 kilómetros aproximadamente y pues lo tenemos dividido en dos zonas, ¿no? La zona de arribadas, que es la primera porción, que son más o menos unos 8 a 9 kilómetros, y lo demás está enfocado más a la tortuga prieta y la última.
Ok. ¿Y qué es lo que hacen cuando tienen arribadas como el día de hoy?
En un principio se hace conteos directos. Después de que se cuenta más de 1.000 tortugas en playa, se pasa a otro método, el método de transectos. Este método es ocupado en todas las playas de Arribada, eso para hacer la comparación significativa entre ellas. Este método se realiza cada 2 horas.
Ok, entonces mientras tengan tortugas en playa más de 1.000 cada 2 horas, tienen que estar midiendo cada 50 metros. No sé si pueden ver aquí en la cámara estas blancas que se ven ahí al fondo, son las marcas que hay a lo largo de toda la playa para poder hacer un montón de trabajo. Creo que no has dormido mucho últimamente,
no,
¿verdad?
No tanto, pero ahí estamos.
Muchísimas gracias, Rafa, y mucha suerte en esta arribada.
Okay, well, this was Rafa working a lot and had the energy to accept this interview. So thank you very much, Rafa. I'm sorry. I have to pass to move. Okay. So this is the status of Escobilla. Some exceptions had happened. A few years ago, I remember that there was an arribada for a month. A little bit more than a month with almost 1 million turtles. So it will change at the beginning of the season. You will, at the beginning and at the end of the season, you will have shorter and less numerous arribadas. And just in the middle of the season, you will have the larger ones. For example, in October is usually the most important one. The global status of oral ridleys was once believed to be so great that they were immune to overexploitation. This belief was halfly true. In fact, the large scale of industrial extraction from the 60s to the 80s brought such alarming crashes in many rockeries, particularly in Mexico, that the species rose the category of endangered on the IUCN red list. Decades of conservation effort from nesting beach protection together with policies banning sea turtle commerce and direct capture on land and at sea have led to very encouraging results from current trend data. Overall trends in most Arribada rockeries are positive or stable over the past 2 decades. Thanks to the work of many people, but of course there are still threats there. Causes of concern remain, including low hatching success that is in many Arribada sites. Pollution, I will talk to you very fast about that. I did my research on that. Plastic ingestion, as many other marine species, climate change, especially for the nests, and also doesn't help with the low hatching success, and above all, fisheries impact. And this is an important threat for all marine turtles. So I want just to show you very fast, I was working like for 7 years doing research in Escobilla. And I found out one of the most important results was the Escobilla population has the highest amount of cadmium. This is a heavy metal around the world compared with any other sea turtle population around the world, but also compared with other marine mammals or megafauna in the world. We have a lot of cadmium in kidney and liver. And this led to multiple publications, scientific publications and others, showing that this may be an important threat for realness in this case in La Escobilla, but many for other species. And I would like, I'm sorry, I jumped out. I would like to help all the people that have me good information, permits, photos, and videos that I show here to this presentation, including last minute requests like today. Thank you to all, to you all. And now I would like to show you what we did. The idea of this, I don't know if you want to say something, Brad, the idea of this webinar, and I want to show Jane's presentation later.
Sure. Yeah, I just wanted to say, so it looked like the video with Rafa was a little bit choppy. Maybe if I try it from my end, since I may have a more stable connection, since you're having some weather there, that I can run the video.
Yes, please.
For the next one. And then I'm also realizing I didn't mention that if people have questions, we'll take them at the end. But you can click on the Q&A at the bottom of your screen, should be at the bottom of your screen. If you want to go ahead and ask questions as we come about, and then we'll get to them at the end in the Q&A. But if you think of it now, feel free to put it in that, not the chat. We're not going to monitor the chat for questions, but the Q&A, go ahead and put those in. And then, yeah, we will get to them at the end. Have you made me the host again yet? I think you're still sharing your screen.
Yes. Okay, I will stop sharing and I will make you host again.
Okay, great. All right. Okay, and do you want to just introduce the video real quick?
Yes, and actually, if the video was not great, maybe you want to show the other videos with your connection that is more stable than in the coast of Oaxaca. Maybe it's a good idea.
Yeah, I can do that. But yeah, do you want to introduce your interview with
Jane? Yeah, this is a video that actually, I think that since I started working with sea turtles, this idea of the release of this chapter, it's our Planet 2 in Netflix. It was 3 years of work for this series. Brad had the idea to do a webinar when the release was finally there. So it was finally last June. And then we start working about that. And this is why we decide also to invite Jamie. He was the producer of the turtle part that was here in Oaxaca, in La Escobilla, and Morro, Utah. So we did, because of the time difference, we record this interview that I did with him.
Yes, okay. So let me go ahead and start that.
Life on Earth depends on the freedom to move. Our Planet 2, only on Netflix.
Well, hi, Jamie. Thank you for accepting this interview and for being here today. I'm very happy. I was visiting Jamie just 2 weeks ago, and now we are organizing this interview, and this was the first excuse to do this webinar. Jamie's experience in Escobilla and Morro, Utah in 2021. Jamie, do you want to introduce yourself, please?
Yes. Thank you, Adriana. Sorry, I can't be there live. But the time difference in London means that we're doing this video instead, which is good for me. But yeah, Adriana and I, and there was a team of us from Silverback Films, two camera operators. We visited Escobilla and Morro, Utah beaches in Oaxaca for about 6 weeks in November and December, which was which was an amazing experience. And the footage that we got there went in a series called Our Planet 2, which is released on Netflix. So Adriana made it happen for us with setting us up in Oaxaca, which is very kind of her.
So I think that people would like more about this. I don't know if everyone of you there have watching it, but I really recommend it. We are in the episode 3. All 4 episodes are great, but episode 3 is the one with the turtles in the very beginning, actually. So I don't know, can you tell us more about your experience and how it was to work in Escobedo Moro? Because actually it's not really easy places. I mean, you are used to rough conditions, but can you tell us more about that?
the conditions were very nice. You know, we're working on a beach for 6 weeks, and we got to spend some time staying in the field station at Moro, Utah, which was great to be there literally on the beach for so long. And as well as Adriana, your help, we of course had the help of Erica and Tere, the managers of the field stations, who were really, really generous with their time and you know, showing us around on the quad bikes, which got directing us to which bits of the beach the hatchlings were likely to hatch out of. And of course, we lived with Tere for you know, many weeks. And we also had the help of the researchers who were working there as well as the in Escobedo, the members of the community also were helping us. They actually made sure that they didn't bring tourists onto the beach especially in the Arribada days, so that we could get these big wide shots of an empty beach with empty of humans but full of thousands and thousands of turtles. So we managed to get these like beautiful wides on the drone, and the community members were holding sort of people back at the edge of the beach. It's just very kind of them. And then we even had some help from the military, from the Marines, who are stationed on Moro and on Escobedo, but we had their help on Moro when I got the truck stuck in a sand dune, and we couldn't take it out. So we got all these Adriana called over the soldiers and they dug us out of the sand dune. So it was a wonderful experience to spend so much time there and have so many helpful people just sort of showing us what to do.
That's amazing. And now, yeah, I think the people was great. I'm so happy also, all the people was so helpful. But you have, what do you think that was your biggest challenge during this shooting? Maybe something more technical? People helping?
Well, for the camera operators, the biggest challenge was getting the sort of look that we were going for, which was what we wanted is to sort of invite people into the point of view of the hatchling turtle. So we get very, very intimate shots. In order to do that, we had to get the cameras very, very, very low. So you'd literally be putting the camera body and lens on the beach, on the sand. As we followed the hatchlings down the beach, there was more and more risk of, you know, wave wash, which was particularly problematic. So I'd be there next to the camera person, there's a wave coming now, and then they'd have to lift all the gear up. So that was quite terrifying. And we did subsequently have some quite scary repair bills I didn't get the warning quite right every time, and there were a few waves that I missed. We had one camera with a long telescopic lens and one slider system. So the aim was to sort of follow the hatchlings down the beach with this motorized slider. But we were using these macro lenses, which is a very, very shallow depth of field. So get the focus on a hatchling turtle, you've probably got a couple of millimeters, and it's all manual focus when you're filming. So it was just very, very, very difficult to keep them sharp. The hatchlings, it turns out, are very, very unpredictable in how they move. I thought they might sort of take a straight line, you know, at a regular speed, but they do the opposite. They'll sort of twist around every turn, or they'll take. They did seem to sort of take 3 or 4 steps and then stop, and then take another 3. So it was just
Yeah,
I couldn't direct them. That was the problem. They weren't listening to me.
Yeah, that's wildlife. And yeah. It's why you did how many hours for 8 minutes on the series?
Yeah, so we calculated it must have been over 100 hours of footage for the 8-minute sequence. It was probably actually more than that. I think it was about 1,000 to 1 basically, in terms of the ratio of what we shot to what we used.
And
tell
me now your favorite shots.
So the favorite bit for me, I think, was when the underwater crew came out towards the end of the shoot, and we went out in a boat from Mazinte down to Escobilla. And at that time, there was a very, very big Arribada. It was maybe before the turtles actually started.
Before, again. Yeah.
Yeah, so the turtles were all just backed up in the ocean. But it's quite difficult from a boat or even from the beach to get a sort of perspective on how many turtles there are in the sea. And when we put the drone up, it was like immediately evident like how like dense they were in the sea, in the ocean. And we kept on pushing the drone higher and higher and higher, expecting that at some point you'd see open water around a sort of aggregation of turtles. But, you know, the shot just keeps on going. It must be like 2 minutes long, and we're on maximum acceleration going up, trying to see where like the edge of this huge mass of turtles is. And it just kept on going. I mean, there must have been over 100,000 turtles in.
Those that survive will swim harder in the next 24 hours than they will ever do again. As they travel, they are imprinted by the Earth's magnetic field, a mental marker that will guide them back when it's their time to breed. Every olive ridley turtle will spend the first 15 years of its life in the Pacific, feeding and growing alone. Each will travel hundreds of thousands of kilometers until one day they change course and begin the long journey back to the beach where they hatched. For the first time in over a decade, this teenage turtle meets others of its own kind. The greatest gathering of turtles on Earth.
Tell me something you didn't know about sea turtles that surprised you the most.
Oh, yeah. Erica, Tara, and of course you, Adriana, told us a lot about turtles in the run-up, which is really helpful, because we tend to write a sort of guide script beforehand before we go out. And we don't know much about the subject, so we spend a good 6 to 8 months sort of swatting up. So, but yeah, we certainly didn't know everything. There were a lot of surprises. And one thing that surprised me was when we were filming the hatchlings. And I think it was you, Adriana, who showed us like how to find them on a beach, or find where they're likely to come out, because we need to set them in the shot. So you remember we had like these time lapses. We had to set the camera up, and then it had to be in the right place to get the whole scene of the emergence. So we were looking. You taught us to look for these little divots, these little holes in the beach. It's like, cool. Some of the they're kind of like a perfect like natural shape. Like some of them were like perfect spheres. What was weird was that in our imagination we thought that the hatchlings would come out of the sand very, very quickly, and they just like rush down the beach because they'd be avoiding the predators. And I think in the script we call it like the race or something like that. But the hatchlings, when they come out of the sand, are actually like very, very slow. Like, you know, it might take an hour for them to fully emerge. And during that time, like most of that time, they're completely still, like a little tiny statue.
Well, if Ridley turtle hatching, in October, the sand is at exactly the right temperature for an emergence. The first to serve it. Yeah. Any movement might attract attention. They must wait for others. They are about to start on the most dangerous journey of their lives. And it's better to do that together.
So after visiting these two important Arribada beaches, which would be the mystery of this phenomena that you would like to know? Because you know there are many things that we don't know yet.
The Arribada itself does seem pretty mysterious. I mean, I know you, Adriana, and others told us a lot of the theories of what happens, but it was just so surprising that when you're there, can you really understand the sheer numbers of the turtles and the density that they're coming onto the beach, and especially on it. When we were there on the biggest Arribada day on Escobilla, like a lot of the time we saw the turtles were digging up each other's eggs, and it seemed quite, in a way, quite counterproductive that they'd all choose exactly the same area on the beach, which is very, very long, and they're all in that one spot.
It's a very long beach, and then you have 4 kilometers pack of turtles, and the rest of the beach is empty.
Yeah.
That's a pretty good question. Why? At least you spot the whole beach.
I know. Yeah. It was great for us because it looks incredible, but
yeah, of course.
But I worried about all those eggs being smashed, you know.
I know. Everyone. Well, thank you very much, Jamie, for sharing with us this experience. And as I told you at the beginning, the release of the episode and of the series, it was the greatest excuse to have this webinar, thinking about all this experience. And thank you for accepting this and being here with us today. And I will tell the people that if they have any questions or more technical things they want to know, maybe we can email you, because at the time this webinar is passing, you will be surely sleeping. So, but we are recording it, and if anyone has a question, maybe you can email us and I will ask you.
Yeah, great. Well, of course, I'd be happy to answer any questions. And thank you for inviting me, and thanks, Adriana, and everyone else at Escobilla and Mora Yuta for all your help during the filming.
All right. Well, yeah, if you have not had a chance to catch that yet, Our Planet 2, I will send out a link, but you can find it pretty easily on Netflix if you get it. And if you did recognize that voice that is the iconic David Attenborough, who for me, he could narrate like making a cup of coffee in the morning, and I would find it fascinating. He's always amazing. And so you got, you know, a small sampling of that footage, but there's plenty more of the Arribada, as well as several other episodes of really amazing stuff. So thank you, Adriana, for helping to put that interview together. And as Adriana mentioned during the video, people can ask questions, I would probably best to reply to the email that I'll send out tomorrow. But if you have any questions for Jamie, then we can try to see, you know, if we can get that then. So moving on from Mexico to Costa Rica, next we're going to be showing a presentation by Dr. Luis Fonseca. He's with Costa Rica Por Siempre, also works with the Guanacaste Dry Forest Conservation Fund on a couple of different beaches in Costa Rica. So I am going to pull that video up and share that. 1 second.
Hola. Para mí es un placer acompañarlos en este webinario. A continuación les voy a contar un poco sobre la experiencia que tenemos en Costa Rica sobre el monitoreo a largo plazo de las arribadas de tortuga lora. En Costa Rica tenemos tres playas de anidación de tortuga lora donde ocurren arribadas. Una es Playa Nancite, que se ubica al norte de Costa Rica, muy cerca de la frontera con Nicaragua. Más al sur tenemos Ostional y un poquito más al sur de Ostional tenemos a Corozalito. Esta última playa se ha descrito recientemente y digamos es una playa que se ha formado prácticamente que en los últimos 10 años como una playa de arribada. En el caso de Nancite, esta se ubica dentro del Parque Nacional Santa Rosa, el cual fue declarado bajo esta categoría de manejo desde 1971. La playa tiene aproximadamente 1 kilómetro de largo. Esta playa tiene la particularidad de que hay una baja presencia humana, ya que es un sitio donde, como pueden ver en la foto, no se ven, no se pueden observar comunidades, y es un sitio que está restringido solamente para la investigación. Incluso no es una playa accesible para el turismo. En el caso de Ostional, Ostional se encuentra dentro del Refugio Nacional de Vida Silvestre. A diferencia de Nancite, en Ostional sí existe una comunidad que vive dentro del refugio. El mismo fue creado en 1983 y esta playa tiene la particularidad de que se permite la extracción legal de huevos. Esto por parte de la Asociación de Desarrollo Integral de Ostional, la cual a través de un trabajo interinstitucional con otras entidades del gobierno, se le permite a las personas de esta comunidad hacer una extracción de huevos controlada durante los días de arribada. Ostional tiene 7 kilómetros de largo. Dentro de Ostional, más o menos viven unas 500 personas y existen actividades turísticas, desarrollos, digamos, inmobiliarios, comercios en general, ¿verdad? Todo lo que ocurre dentro de una comunidad. ¿Qué hacemos acá en Costa Rica? Creo que los parámetros más importantes que nosotros medimos y que hemos estado monitoreando a largo plazo, ya por más de 12 años de manera simultánea en ambas playas, tanto en Nancite como en Ostional, una es estimar el número de hembras anidantes, ¿verdad? Vean que es muy difícil poder contar una a una, cada una de las tortugas, ¿verdad? Eso es un trabajo casi que imposible de realizar. Entonces tenemos un método de estimación que se llama el método de transectos, que se utiliza en todas las playas derribadas en el mundo, ¿verdad? Y algo que también es muy importante es estimar la producción de neonatos. Entonces, básicamente, nuestro monitoreo se enfoca en estos dos parámetros. Acá en estas gráficas pueden ver números de Nancite y de Ostional. Vean que si nos fijamos en las cifras más altas de Ostional por año, vean que han habido años, por ejemplo, como el 2014, donde llegaron como 1.200.000 tortugas a desovar al refugio, ¿verdad? Y vean que Anacite, contrariamente, las arribadas más grandes, ¿verdad?, ocurrieron en el 2017, donde apenas llegaron como a las 120.000 nidadas por año. Vean que uno podría decir, básicamente, viendo estos números, que más o menos por cada 10 tortugas que llegan a desovar a ostional, está llegando una anansite. Las arribadas más grandes que hemos tenido, vean que en ostional, en octubre del 2008, hubo una arribada muy grande de casi 500.000 tortugas, ¿verdad? Y vean que en otros momentos han tenido arribadas que han superado las 300.000 las 300.000 tortugas por arribada. En el caso de Nancite, vean que los números son mucho más bajos, ¿verdad? Vean que en Nancite la cifra más alta es de 57.000 tortugas en noviembre del 2020, 17, y en noviembre del 2017 también un valor similar superando las 50.000 tortugas. Esta es la tendencia de ostional del año 2007 al año 2022. Vean que si hacemos una comparación desde el año 1, que en este caso es el 2007, al año 2022, podríamos estar pensando que la población ha crecido como un 36%. Algo importante es que en ostional, como les mencioné al inicio de la presentación, hay cosecha de huevos por la comunidad, ¿verdad? Entonces, estos valores que están acá en una línea gris con puntitos negros, vean que estos porcentajes representan del total de huevos que llegaron a poner las tortugas en la playa, cuántos fueron extraídos por las personas. Entonces vean que esos valores han andado fluctuando entre un 3 y casi un 7% dependiendo del año. Esa es la cantidad de huevos que están extrayendo, digamos, las personas de la comunidad. Y ahorita vamos a ver que en realidad esa extracción, según nuestros datos, ¿verdad?, no está siendo ningún perjuicio o ninguna presión negativa, digamos, para la población. En el caso de Nancite, tenemos una gráfica similar a la ostional. La historia de Nancite es un poco más larga. Vean que hay datos desde el año 1980, ¿verdad? Nancite, digamos, es una población que ha ido decreciendo, ¿verdad? Ya de lo que se veía de los 70s, en algunos reportes anecdóticos, la información de los 80s y lo que se veía ya a mitad de los 90s era que la población había disminuido considerablemente, ¿verdad? Ven que incluso su punto más bajo llegó a ser más o menos entre el periodo de 1980 y el 2010, donde la población había reducido casi un 93%. Sin embargo, si ya lo comparamos con los últimos años, específicamente con el 2020, podemos ver que hay una tendencia, digamos, leve a recuperarse, donde la disminución, digamos, como que se ha detenido y más bien ha empezado como a ser una subida, digamos, en el número de tortugas que está llegando anualmente a la playa. Esto es básicamente la presentación que yo tenía. Obviamente quiero agradecer a todos los aliados, ¿verdad?, que han estado apoyando este monitoreo tanto en Nancite como en Ostional. Ahí aparecen los logos de esos aliados, ¿verdad? De mi parte, esa sería mi presentación. Muchísimas gracias.
Okay, so thank you so much, Luis, for putting that presentation together. It's a really great overview of the two main nesting beaches there in Costa Rica. And like I said, we'll have Luis available for questions at the Q&A here at the end. And then I also wanted to pull up a short interview that we recorded last year when Adriana visited Nancite, and kind of a unique thing that they have there in Nancite that we were able to get some info about. So I will share that.
Hi, I am Adriana from Sea Turtles. Today I am at the Pacific side of Costa Rica in Nancite with Luis Fonseca. Thank you, Luis, for having me here. ¿Nos puedes contar más un poco acerca de lo que hacen ustedes aquí en Nancite, Luis?
Claro, Adriana. Nosotros en realidad tenemos un proyecto de conservación de tortugas marinas enfocado principalmente en la tortuga lora. Esta especie hace arribadas en esta playa
Es la principal investigación que desarrollamos acá. Tenemos un monitoreo que hemos venido efectuando desde hace 18 años. Ese trabajo lo queremos seguir realizando continuamente a través del tiempo.
Ya que, aunque sea una playa pequeña de solo 1 kilómetro, tienen arribadas, ¿verdad? Estiman, ¿nos puedes decir el estimado más o menos de su población?
Sí, en realidad nosotros tenemos entre 75.000 y 115.000 nidos por año, ¿no? Es el número que se estima a través de las arribadas, y eso está produciendo arriba de 2,5 millones de neonatos cada año.
Una playa muy productiva para ser tan pequeñita. Y no, no solo eso, en este lugar acabo de conocer, hoy en la mañana, vi un jaguar. Hay una interacción muy importante de jaguares y tortugas, que además es una población de jaguares que está creciendo. ¿Nos puedes contar un poco más? Porque también hacen investigación, por supuesto, ahora con ellos.
Sí, en realidad, Diana, como decís, eso fue algo que ha ocurrido en los últimos 10 años. Cuando empezamos a trabajar acá en el CITE, no era común ver un jaguar o sus huellas sobre la playa, ni ver tortugas depredadas. Sin embargo, a partir del año 2010 empezamos a documentar esas depredaciones que estaban ocurriendo en la playa y empezamos, utilizando cámaras trampa, a identificar cada uno de los jaguares. Y esto lo podemos hacer gracias a que los jaguares en su piel tienen manchas que son únicas para cada individuo. Entonces viene siendo como la huella digital de nosotros, ¿verdad? Entonces eso nos ayuda a poder diferenciar y decir, este es el individuo 1 o el individuo 2.
O Josué, o como se llame.
Exacto.
Si quieren apoyar este proyecto que protege tortugas y también jaguares, que es uno de los únicos seguramente en Latinoamérica y el mundo donde es muy fácil ver un jaguar por la noche o por las mañanas, como yo tuve la suerte, pueden visitar nuestra página seaturtle.org y en nuestros socios van a encontrar la forma de poder apoyar a Nancite, este proyecto y otros más. Muchas gracias, Luis, por todo el trabajo tan grande que hacen.
As you can see, my cat decided it was a good moment to visit as well. She must have seen the jaguars on the screen. Yeah, the joys of working from home. We are now ready for our final presentation, our next live presentation. Vanessa, are you ready?
I'm here. I really hope the internet cooperates. It was pretty bad there in the beginning, so hopefully you don't lose me.
Okay, yeah, we'll cross our fingers. Well, your video popped up there for a second. Ah, there you are. So Dr. Vanessa Beezy from the Wildlife Conservation Association in Costa Rica. Let me pass the hosting over to you, and you can take it away, and we'll cross our fingers that everything works good. There we go, make hosts.
Right. Well, thanks already so much for including me. It's very humbling to be next to Adriana and Luis and all the amazing work that they're doing at other Arribada sites. Today, since they did such a great introduction, I'm going to be focusing specifically on my PhD research and the current conservation work that I'm doing here at the Ocional National Wildlife Refuge in Costa Rica. Just for those of you that aren't familiar with the location, we're in Central America, and Ocional is located on the northern Pacific coast of Costa Rica, just about a 3 hours drive south of Nancite. And as Luis so wonderfully introduced, Ocional is essentially the second most important nesting beach in the world for the olive ridley turtle, just after Escobilla. We have mass nesting events here almost every single month of the year. In some cases, we have 2, and this year for the first time we had 3 in a single month, and there's a few months here there where we might skip, but overall there's very consistent mass nesting here, and I personally always found this behavior just incredibly fascinating. And as a scientist, what is really intriguing to me is how little we really know and understand about this behavior. Like Adriana said, you know, just the ridley turtles are the ones that are participating in this type of behavior, and we don't really understand exactly how or even why the sea turtles are supposedly deciding to nest all together, because they could certainly nest on their own as well. So my dissertation focused on starting to tackle the question of how the turtles are timing their nesting together. And in many projects, a lot of people have noticed that there is a relationship seemingly with the lunar phase. And this is, Oceanal is not the exception. Anyone in town will tell you that there's a certain phase of the moon that they expect the mass nesting event to occur. But what we wanted to look at for my dissertation was all types of different environmental variables and whether these could actually even be used to predict when events would happen. So we included lots of long-term monitoring data, thanks to groups like Luis's, who've been collecting data in Oceanal for over 10 years, and compared this to temperature, ocean currents, wind velocity, and lunar phase. 10 different variables were included. And it turns out that there's not a single variable that can really very well predict when these events will occur. But if we were to pick the best one, then the lunar phase is certainly what helps us best predict the timing of mass nesting events. And so this graph shows you essentially the lunar cycle, and each dot represents a single mass nesting event in that 10-year period and when it occurred. So you can see here that most of the Arribadas in Oceanal are occurring right around the time of the last quarter moon. And so that, in essence, is the best way for us as scientists and also for tourists to plan when they are most likely to see a mass nesting event in Oceanal. But as you can see, there's also events that are happening at the first quarter moon. So this is not something that is kind of the end all be all rule for when these events can occur. So the next step after that, for me personally, was I was really intrigued at what was going on in the water. Could we see whether turtles were somehow organizing themselves before coming up onto the beach? And so we decided to get a new perspective, come off of the beach. We used a drone to fly these transects up and down the coast of Oceanal, going about 3 kilometers out. And essentially what I was doing, very similar to what you see in the picture here, was counting exactly how many turtles were at the surface at a set distance from shore. And we did that for an entire year for every 3 days. And this graph essentially shows what we saw. Each dot on this graph represents a turtle that we saw a set distance from shore on the date that we were monitoring. The red bars indicate the start of an Arribada event, and these gray areas with the dashed lines are times when we were not monitoring. We didn't have the drone up in the air, so we don't have that data. But what you can see really kind of by looking at it quickly is obviously we have far more turtles, and they're very close together right between August and December. That's when we see the largest events. And what was interesting is that there's not very much organization that we can tell, at least from the footage and the analysis, but you can see that they do tend to start to group closer together and slowly move closer to shore. And they're especially obviously very close to shore right when these events are starting and turtles are coming up and off the beach. And then this graph is very similar, except this is showing you the density of turtles per square kilometer on those days. And we had days in Oceanal where we had essentially 1,000 sea turtles per square kilometer, which equates to about 1 turtle per square meter, which is kind of the size of like a basic 4-top table. So that's a lot of turtles. On average in Oceanal, throughout the entire year, we had an average of 252 turtles per square kilometer. Just to put that into context, some sites working with more endangered turtles, for example, would quote something like 0.001 turtles per square kilometer. So we certainly have a lot of turtles here. But even that being said, even turtle biologists, I think, struggle understanding the scale of just how many turtles that means. Just like the videographer was sharing, trying to really put an image to how many turtles are around you. So I'm gonna share with you some special footage that we captured during this research that is essentially a similar shot to what they were describing for our planet. Oh, sorry. Oh, no. Let's take it out a bit. So on this day, this is the day that we had, as I mentioned, essentially 1,000 turtles per square kilometer. And I took that drone very high up and could not find the edge of where all of these turtles were. So to move forward from there, we wanted to start to address the main hypothesis for how most scientists think that turtles might be coordinating this behavior is that they could be using a pheromone, which is essentially a smell or chemical cue that influences the behavior of other individuals. And so to test this hypothesis is very complicated, but our try at this was essentially to capture turtles just offshore in Ostunal, essentially right where we were filming that video in the days before an event we were expecting in Arribada. And half of those turtles received what I essentially call a nose numbing solution. It's kind of similar to when you get your tooth numbed at the dentist. It's temporary. And we did this with half of the turtles and then waited to see if the Arribada started and looked for those turtles nesting on the beach. And what you see here is essentially each night of the Arribada and how many turtles we've re-encountered on the beach. The ones in blue are the ones that just got salt water up their nose, so that has no effect. And the ones in red are the ones that got that nose numbing solution. And those turtles actually nested significantly later in the event when we would expect them to regain their sense of smell. And so these results are really exciting and interesting. We can't make any big conclusions, but it does definitely seem like the timing of nesting for sea turtles in general, or maybe even specifically for the Arribada, is something that can be influenced by their sense of smell. And so for the last bit of my presentation, I wanted to take a step back after sharing my dissertation results. I started working and living here in the area and wanted to remind everyone that the Ostunal National Wildlife Refuge is actually a lot more than just Ostunal and sea turtles. You can see here in blue is the marine protected area and in green is our terrestrial protected area. And this refuge actually embodies many different communities and includes the fastest growing surf town in the world. Nosara or Playa Guiones has been a booming tourism and development destination. And unfortunately, this place just next door to the sea turtle sanctuary is facing some really major conservation challenges, such as over-tourism, rapid habitat degradation by constructions, sewage pollution, and illegal landfills and dumps. So after witnessing all of that, that is essentially what motivated me to found, and I now direct the Wildlife Conservation Association. We are dedicated to protecting sea turtles and other wildlife here at the Ostunal National Wildlife Refuge. And we are working to essentially conduct research and education initiatives that can inspire the local community to towards positive environmental action. We work really closely with many different partners and community organizations here to help protect this really important site. And so in addition to the different research and monitoring initiatives that we conduct to collect data that's really important towards conservation, we also implement these in different types of educational programs and collaborations. I specifically wanted to highlight one project that is funded by Sea Turtles. We are establishing a precious plastic project, which is essentially a plastic recycling project that is going to take plastic that would otherwise end up in the ocean and make it into products that can be sold to continue funding ongoing recycling efforts here in the area. And with that, I just want to thank especially Sea Turtles for inviting me and hosting this and for supporting our organization. I also want to make special mention to the National Science Foundation, which was the major funder for most of my dissertation work, primarily with a grant to my advisor, Dr. Ken Lohman, but also with the Graduate Research Fellowship Program. And I want to also acknowledge all of our local collaborators, especially the Ostunal National Wildlife Refuge and the many, many different people that had their hands in all of that research, including volunteers. Especially for our organization, the Wildlife Conservation Association is primarily funded by donors and small grants. So all of that support is really important and would not be possible otherwise. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much, Vanessa. That was tremendous. I remember It was at a sea turtle symposium. I think it was in South Carolina, where you showed that drone footage. And that was, for me, I think that was one of the first times that I've seen drones being used in sea turtle research. And yeah, I remember you're showing it to a meeting of Latin American sea turtle researchers. Yes, my doggy's getting into the presentation now. And seeing it pan out and just everybody in the room being stunned at the sheer size of it. And, you know, the size of the Arribada was not a surprise to anybody in the room. We're all familiar with it, but just to see the way that that came through and that footage was just phenomenal. So I was so glad you were able to join us and talk about it. You've definitely got some really interesting research coming along, and we hope that you and your colleagues are able to keep unlocking some of these mysteries. So yeah, thank you so much. And like I said, I will send out information about all these different projects, links, social media, and everything tomorrow. So we have a few questions. Luis, if you want to bring up your video, I see we have several questions here. And I will pass them along to different people. Luis, si quiere, yeah, listo, hola. So I will direct some of these questions to some of our researchers. The first two look like they were for Adriana. You see them in the Q&A there, you said?
Yes, I do.
Great.
Well, Silvia Fuentes was asking in El Salvador, they are trying to educate about the importance of sea turtles in their country for the investigation of the metal. Is there a process already? Any information you can share as people in our country still eat them a lot? And yes, I can share for sure. I can share some papers and more information about that. Because especially I think that this cadmium thing, it's all along the Pacific, or a good part of the Pacific has this problem, because I also published some that, no, I'm sorry, I didn't publish actually. I did some necropsies, and I also study other species like two leatherbacks, some green turtles, some sea lions and dolphins, and they all are really packed with cadmium. Just to say, leatherbacks were the one with the higher cadmium. So yeah, for sure, I can share more information with you. Brad will share the emails, and I think that they really need some more, maybe papers, but also information to can share during your educational programs. And the second is Roldan. Hey, Roldan. Are there high levels of heavy metals related to any ill effects on the ridleys? Yes, they were. And actually, I thought at the beginning they were like a super strong, like there is too much cadmium that I thought, okay, there are used to already. Nothing is happening. But I did some oxidative stress research. I did some asymmetric research, a blood serum test, and they were all related to cadmium. I mean, the negative effects. And I also did at the end that it's not published either. I have to publish some couple of papers published left. But I did also histopathology in kidneys, and they were bad. It was worse than I thought, I think. And we also find a relationship between the cadmium was like 10 times, if I remember well, or maybe more, higher in dead turtles than in live turtles in blood. So it means that the turtles also, I think that after many, all these years, I think that cadmium has something to do with at least some of the deaths of the turtles and half of the death of the turtle that I found. Okay.
That's yeah. Yes, and hello to Roldan. Roldan's with the Sea Turtle Conservancy, has done quite a bit of research on the Arribada himself. So Roldan, glad you can join us. The next question from Julie, it says, it looked like one hatchling had sand on its eyes. Do they have a special membrane that protects their eyes from damage? I'm going to give this one to Luis. Dice que durante el video que parece que una de las tortuguitas tenía un poquito de arena en el ojo. ¿Tienen un tipo de, cómo se dice, membrano o algo en el ojo para protegerlo de la arena.
Gracias, Brad. Sí, en realidad las tortugas tienen una membrana que, y también ellos tienen los lagrimales, digamos, en el ojo, que permiten como limpiar también esa arena, ¿verdad? Entonces las tortugas en realidad, sobre todo las adultas, cuando están en el mar, ellas están de alguna manera siempre llorando, digamos, ¿verdad? Y es una manera de ellas de eliminar de su sistema renal, digamos, ¿verdad? La sal, y por eso es que ellas pueden, tienen la capacidad de poder tomar agua salada, digamos, ¿verdad? Digamos, a diferencia de los humanos que no podemos tomar agua salada.
Okay, so to translate that, so yes, they do have a membrane that protects their eyes. And he says that also their tear ducts, that the turtles are always in a form of sort of crying, and that those tears also help to clear their eyes. And so when they take in salt water, that's how they extrude the excrete, I think is actually the
excrete,
word.
Excrete, yes.
Yeah, excrete the salt from their bodies when they take it in, when they open their mouths. Underwater. So yes, they have a couple of ways to protect their eyes. That's a great question, Julie. Next question from Carol. Vanessa, is this one you think you can answer? Have any of the turtles that have been seen at Ostional been seen on other beaches? How strong is the site fidelity?
So absolutely. I think in both Ostional and Encite, there's record of turtles that both participate in the Arribada at that site, but then might go somewhere else and nest solitarily. So they can interchange in that behavior. And so we do think they have very strong site fidelity, but they're not limited at all to Ostional Beach. They might go up and down this coast. And in fact, our colleague Christine Finner has some great tracks of turtles, but she was tracking them once they left the nesting beach. But we do have different projects up and down the coast that will see tags from turtles that were tagged in Arribada and Ostional and end up nesting elsewhere.
And also I would like to add to that, to the Christine's work. I think that they have been to publish, but they found a turtle that actually went promotional. They went to nest then to Escobilla Beach or Morro. I don't remember very well, but sometimes we may maybe even exchange some turtles.
Oh, that's, yeah, wow. That's quite a distance.
Yeah.
The next one is listed for you, Adriana. I think maybe Vanessa can probably also add some advice, or Luis as well. Any advice for young turtle biologists in graduate school?
Well, yes, just to say I'm veterinarian for the base, so it doesn't matter very well. Of course, biologist is the first one, but sometimes many people from many different schools have been turtle people at the end. Some people even not go into lawyer school. I mean, if you are turtle passionate, just keep working and you can do that. And I don't know, Vanessa.
Yeah, I think that was perfectly said. I would have said the same thing. Just find what you enjoy. If you enjoy turtle work, just keep doing that and you'll find a way to make it work. Just keep looking for opportunities and be persistent.
It's not easy, let's say, but it's worth it. You are on mute, Brad.
Luis, ¿algún consejo para estudiantes en la universidad?
Sí, en realidad es muy importante involucrar a sobre todo a los niños más pequeños, sobre todo de escuela, digamos, en el sentido de poder sensibilizarlos a ellos de manera que sientan que la naturaleza y especialmente las tortugas marinas, ¿verdad?, son muy importantes para la conservación, ¿verdad? Entonces, si uno empieza con las generaciones más pequeñas, es posible que a través del tiempo podamos tener gente más educada, con más conocimiento, con más conciencia. Entonces, es clave la educación ambiental para cumplir con nuestras metas de conservación.
Okay, great. Yeah, so just to translate that quickly, saying as much as you can, get the younger generations involved and excited, get them out to the beach if possible. You know, the more education that we can do for the younger grades, the younger ages, you know, the more that people will grow up with an appreciation for these animals. I see Selena has a couple of questions. Let's see, Roldan. I'm going to skip down to some folks that we haven't answered a question to yet because we're running a bit over. Ashley is asking, how is the legal take of sea turtle eggs evolved, and the allowance of some of taking some eggs improved conservation? Luis, ¿entiendes o quieres que traduzco esta pregunta? Es acerca del programa legal de colección de huevos.
Mejor traduzca ahora, por favor.
¿Cómo? Sí, es cómo ha sido la colecta legal, cómo ha evolucionado esto y cómo este puede mejorar la conservación.
Sí, en realidad voy a hablar como por partes, ¿verdad? Para tal vez para que sea un poco más fácil para traducir para usted. Okay. Algo muy importante es que el gobierno de Costa Rica, digamos, ha permitido que la Asociación de Desarrollo de Ostenal, que son personas de la comunidad, ellos pueden realizar la extracción de huevos a través de un programa que está bien estructurado con el gobierno. Y tenemos otras instituciones del gobierno, aparte del SINAC, digamos, como el INCOPESCA, que es el Instituto de Pesca de Costa Rica, y SENASA, que es un instituto que tiene que ver con la salud animal. Es un trabajo interdisciplinario, ha permitido que la gente pueda colectar huevos legalmente, digamos, ¿verdad? Y ellos tienen un etiquetado de cada uno de sus empaques, donde dice, este huevo es legalmente de Ostional. Y esa trazabilidad que se le ha podido dar a los productos es una garantía, digamos, de que la conservación se está haciendo de una buena manera.
Okay.
En primera parte.
Yeah, yeah. So, just to go over that, the government of Costa Rica has allowed for, ¿por cuánto tiempo? Por 30 años.
1987, ¿verdad?
87, since 1987, has allowed the local development association, so members of the community of Ostional, to collect under some very strict regulations, eggs. I believe it's the first eggs that are laid during the Arribada, to collect them to sell for personal consumption. And they get receipts for them, and they're under very strict regulations so that it's not an uncontrolled harvest of the eggs.
Yeah, algo muy importante, ¿verdad? Es que la combinación de la extracción de huevos con la investigación científica que hemos desarrollado, digamos, en conjunto entre el gobierno de Costa Rica, la universidad, por ejemplo, donde está Roland Valverde, Vanessa, que en algún momento también ha estado involucrado en el proyecto, y otros investigadores, han permitido determinar que en realidad la extracción de huevos no tiene ningún perjuicio para las tortugas. Es un porcentaje muy bajo que se extrae, que no, digamos, que no afecta negativamente la producción de neonatos en la playa.
What he's saying is that through the work of people like Luis, Vanessa, Roldan, Carlos Mario Orrego, have been researching the effect of the legal egg collection on the population. And so what they're finding is that it's a very small percentage of the eggs that are allowed to be collected, and that most of the eggs that are laid, unlike going off script a little bit here, but an olive ridley nesting by itself, most of those eggs will hatch and become hatchings. But on an Arribada beach, a very small percentage of them do, because succeeding waves of turtles are digging up nests. You heard Jamie mention in his talk that some of the nests get dug up or get crushed by succeeding turtles that come in, because it's a very small space that they're in. So that they found over the decades that the taking of the eggs does not reduce the number of hatchlings that are produced on the beach, so that it's not having a negative impact. And it's also having a positive economic impact on the community, that these funds are a very important source of income for the members of the local community. Now, this program is not without some controversy. There are plenty of people that don't think that Costa Rica's government should be allowing this. But, you know, the research by lots of people, as they've said, has you know, shown pretty clearly, it seems like, that at this beach, that it's not having a huge impact on, or it's not having a negative impact on this population of turtles. And as Luis was talking about, the numbers of nesting turtles at Ostional over the past few decades has been increasing. Vanessa, yeah, go ahead.
I just wanted to chime in, since that person specifically asked about conservation, that part of that program actually also requires the community to participate in conservation activities. So they have security guards up and down the beach every single night of the year. They are also doing beach cleanups to remove driftwood and trash, other debris from the beach, and protecting hatchlings, all of which is essentially funded by that program. And would not occur otherwise, honestly. So those are very important conservation efforts that are essentially priceless, that the community is contributing in exchange for that, essentially that right and that responsibility to harvest eggs.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, thank you for adding that. I personally wasn't aware of that, but that's excellent. So I think we'll do two more questions since we're starting to run fairly late. We have another one of our sea turtle colleagues, question from Janet. Such a fascinating webinar. Impressive to see the drone footage. I agree. Do you see a lot of mating pairs start prior to the start of the Arribada season? And are transmitters utilized at all to see returning frequency and movement? Adriana, we haven't heard from you in a little bit. Are you aware of able to answer that for Escobilla?
Yes, yeah, you see a lot of matings, especially before the season, but you also will see the matings all the season long, because they are not like a mating aggregations, like turtles in front of the beach for the Arribada. So you will see, if you go in a boat all around, you will see matings most of the time during the season. And unfortunately, actually, in Escobilla, we don't have a lot of information about following the turtles. That was some frustrating thing during my postdoc, because it was something that I wanted to do, to see, to check where this cadmium, that drives me crazy, were coming from. But we really need to know where there are the feeding areas. And as surprising as it is, even if it's the largest population worldwide, we don't really know exactly their location and their patterns. I put some satellites, but transmitters, but they stopped working very, very fast, so we couldn't see a lot. And there is a lot more work left to do about that. In Mexico, at least in Oaxaca, there is almost nothing. More work has been done recently in Costa Rica, as Vanessa said, by Christine, actually, as the one that got the financing to place like many transmitters, at least few of them. So, but I think that there are more programs following other species of turtles, because are more in danger than ridleys. Ridleys are very low prioritized for research and for funding. And this is a really big problem when you are working with ridleys.
Yeah, as Adriana is saying, of the seven species of sea turtles, six are classified, you know, as some form of status of endangered, and, you know, five of them are higher, well, let's see, the hawksbills, the greens, and the loggerheads are all classified as, you know,
critical endanger.
Yeah, more endangered than olive ridleys. And
we know more about their migration areas, actually, about leatherbacks, about hawksbills, about them, that we know way more than ridleys.
Well, leatherbacks are also vulnerable, but, you know, the Eastern Pacific population is critically endangered. Very few of them left, unfortunately. So, yeah, some of the other species get a lot more of the research and conservation funding than the olive ridleys. So, yeah, if you ask an olive ridley researcher,
we are the last on the list.
Vanessa, was there anything you wanted to add to that?
No, I mean, I think she answered perfectly. We have the same thing here in Ustinal. We really have, we have mating pairs everywhere. And the little that we do know is mostly thanks to Christine's work. And sometimes just, you know, simple recapture of tags. So maybe nothing fancy like a satellite transmitter, but, you know, between projects, there's some recaptures that way as well.
Okay. And yeah, so we'll wrap up with this last question from Mary. Vanessa, you started to talk about it a little bit at the end of your presentation about the tourism there in Ustinal.
Yeah, sorry, was the question like how to, I think there was a question about how to do a responsible tour.
Yeah, well, is access restricted and how close can tourists get?
Yeah, so I can speak about Ustinal. I'm not sure what it's like in Escobilla, but in Ustinal, access to the beach is absolutely restricted during any nesting. And now they're starting to do that more often also for hatching events to protect the turtles. You're required to be with a local certified guide to be on the beach, and group sizes are limited to a maximum of 9 people per guide. So that is very much controlled and has improved since the photo that I shared on my presentation, I'm happy to say, has much improved, but there's still a lot of work to be done, to be honest with you. But in general, I think that you can have a low impact tour at almost any Arribada beach. And that's thanks to the fact that turtles that engage in this behavior overall are much less likely to get disturbed. So I would argue if you're going to go watch a turtle nest, make it a Ridley during an Arribada, because they will, quite frankly, they'll crawl all over you. They don't care about your presence. They'll go do their thing. And you're very unlikely to, you know, disturb or bother a turtle in that scenario, compared to, you know, a leatherback or green turtle, in the night. You're much more likely to disturb that turtle. So I think that the Arribada is really special for that reason. It's just such a great opportunity to get to see a turtle, to see all stages of nesting, and in some cases get to see that even in the daytime, where you're just a lot less likely to bother the turtle. So as long as the tourism is properly managed, which I think at least in Ustinal that has improved a lot, then you can certainly, I encourage you to go see it. It's definitely a bucket list item.
Yeah, that's great to hear. I know there was a lot of concern when those photos went around of some, you know, fairly uncontrolled tourism. So that's really great to hear that that's improved quite a bit. And yeah, and Adriana, Escobilla?
In Escobilla, I think that it also was a huge impact, the photos in Costa Rica, actually, because they didn't want to have the same problem here. What helps a lot is the unpredictable of the phenomena, because you really need to be lucky enough to be around. And the Escobilla Beach is pretty easy access from some tourist areas, so they have, but they also have community guides, certified community guides. And actually, they were thinking about that since the pictures actually about try to keep the people and the guides before the Arribada, like behind. They have a little a little hill where you can see a little bit from the higher distance. And during the shooting from Netflix, they get the guides agree with that. So they start staying a little bit on the back more than go in the middle of the Arribada, which was good. And I mean, there is many things to do, but I think that they know that they have to change all that. And with certified guides, I think that so far it's good. It can be improved, but it's good. And I think in Dancite they don't have those problems, which is great. So far, so yeah, difficult to get to Dancite.
Yes.
In Dancite, la situación es diferente a Ustinal y a México, digamos. Nosotros en Dancite, la playa está dentro de un parque nacional. Es un lugar un poco lejos, digamos, de las ciudades y del centro del parque. Y la administración del Parque Nacional ha decidido que Nancite es un sitio restringido, donde no se permite turismo, solamente hay investigadores, entonces no tenemos un problema de turismo, tampoco hay botes llegando, digamos, como a visitar la Arribada, digamos, desde la playa, entonces la verdad las tortugas ahí pasan muy tranquilas, digamos, durante las Arribadas.
Yeah, so to translate that real quick, so Nancite, where Luis works, is inside of a national park. It's very challenging to get to, as Adriana can attest to. It's a quite a hike in, and it's very restricted to scientific research purposes. There aren't boats coming there, so those turtles are, Luis says, it's very, very tranquilo for them, other than the jaguars, at least. But at least when it regards to people, it's you know, it's a pretty calm beach. But yeah, and so just to finish up with that, sea turtles, we do offer a trip to Oaxaca to go to Escobilla. We try to time it for the Arribada, as we've been saying. You can't really predict, as everyone has mentioned. You know, you can kind of guess, but you can't totally predict. We have a trip this December, which is full. Hopefully some of those folks that are joining us were able to join us tonight. But we will have trips in the future. We will send more of those. Adriana leads that trip. Also, hopefully to see some leatherbacks and stuff too. Anyway, we're going to wrap it up there. Thank you so much, Vanessa, Luis, Adriana as well.
Thank you.
Or Rafa for joining us by video, and Jamie as well. Thank you so much. If you have other questions, feel free to respond to the email that I'm going to send out tomorrow, and we'll try to get them answered for you as well. And have a great evening. Thank you for joining us. Have a good night.
Bye.
Good night.